Rani mentioned in it. The Karma Yoga is basically trying to teach all of us that whatever actions we are taking, whatever we are doing, our karma, our actions have to be irrelevant, not dependent on the result. It is also called Nishkam Karma, where all your actions are done, you do it without waiting or looking forward to the result of your karma. That is what it means. The next chapter is Gyan Karma Sanyas Yoga. And here there is a definition of who is a righteous person and a non-righteous person, which has around 42 shlokas in itself. The next is Karma Sanyas Yoga, where there are 29 shlokas, and there is a difference between, I'll give it to you with an example. We talked about people who are fighting for Duryodhan, who is the evil person, and Pandav, who is the right side, the dharma and the adharma. Now, what is happening here is that when we learn in this chapter that dharma and adharma are to be defined and learned with the person who is into dhyan, bhakti and karma. There are three aspects of it and the basic differentiation of it. That is how we learn to read this chapter. After that, the next is Atam Sanyam Yoga, where Sri Krishna is trying to tell that there are five senses: the eyes, the nose, the tongue, the ear, and skin. They are the five senses, and there's one more. It's called Man, which is, when we read Gita, there's this particular sentence where Arjun comes up with that, O Krishna, my man is even faster than the speed of wind. Please understand, as it is, we talk about the five senses which are looking outwardly. They're not looking inwardly. The vision is looking out, eyes are looking out, ears, whether you don't tell your ears to listen. If there is a sound, there is a conversation, your ears look. If there's a smell, you are taking your breath, the smell being positive or negative, it is going in your nostrils. You're not obstructing it. All right. But that is what the chapter is saying, that you have to be a person who has a control on all the five senses and moreover on your mind. Now here I want to share something. We remember that Duryodhan is born to Dhritarashtra and Gandhari. Let me share a small incident. Dhritarashtra is blind by vision since birth, and he gets married to Gandhari, who is the mother of the 100 Kauravas. Gandhari decides to blindfold herself because she wants to live an ideal life of the kind that her husband is blind. So she wants to live a life like that. And they have a son who is Duryodhan. Duryodhan is not blinded by sight, but he is blinded by vision. I feel, it's my opinion, that only if Gandhari had not blindfolded herself, she would have been able to see the wrongs, the rights of her children, and especially Duryodhan, who was blinded by ego, who was blinded by the ahem that he had. So basically, I try and relate it to today's times parents, where the parents are not checking, not taking care, not correcting, or turning a blind eye to their child's folly, and they lead to having children like Duryodhan, who are not blinded by vision, but not blinded by sight, but by vision. Further to this, there are other chapters, Gyan Vigyan, which has a yog, which has 30 shlokas, Akshar Brahma Yog, which has around 28 shlokas, Raj Vidya Raj Guhu Yog, which has around 34 shlokas, Vibhuti Yog, that is another one of my very favorite chapters. Vibhuti Yog has around 42 shlokas in it. And it is the chapter where Shri Krishna, who is the almighty creator, preserver, and the destroyer of the world, is talking about his vibhutis, his endless powers. He says and mentions that I exist from a basic granule of sand to the Sumeru Parvat, which is the mountain. He says that he exists from in an ant to an elephant. Now, this is one chapter which I really feel like resonating and trying and telling people that it is one of the most beautiful things to learn, to see the endless power of energy, of God in everything, materialistic, non-materialistic. The time we understand the energy and the power of the God's, you know, existence in everything, we learned this chapter very beautifully. The next part is another chapter, which is called Vishwarup Darshan Yog. It has around 28 shlokas.
I think there's an internet issue going on. There seems to be quite a bit of that going on. Archana, you're back? Great. Just unmute yourself. Could you please?
Yeah. Yes. Okay. Yes. So, Anu, I think it's already 11:30. Should I hurry it up a bit?
Okay. That would be nice.
The next is Bhakti Yoga. We learn to do worship, not only of ideals. It's a worship which we learn of Akar and Nirakar both, where the God is telling that I exist in everything. There is no shape to me. There is no size to me. I am existing in each and every one. And that's the beauty of Bhagavad Gita, that if we can learn not only to worship the ideals lying in our temples, but each and every person and everything that we have around us, akar or nirakar, I think our worship is going to be very pure and energetic. The next chapter is Kshetra and Kshetragya Vibhag Yoga. This is another very beautiful chapter where we are learning from the beginning about Atma, Sharir, and Paramatma. Here, we are talking about the body and the soul, which is the supreme power, Paramatma's ansh or part. Okay. The next is Guntre Vibhag Yoga. That is another very beautiful chapter with 27 shlokas. And here we are learning about, there are a few words which you must have ever heard. It's called Satogun, Rajogun, and Tamogun. These gun are not only existing in one particular sphere. They exist in our thought. They exist in our food. That's what Gita is teaching us. Our thought, food, action, and personalities. We are sattvic, rajasic, or tamasic. and it is extensively mentioned in this chapter. The next chapter is Purushottam Yoga, where the power of word, Akshar, Kshar and Purushottam is discussed by Lord Krishna. The next is Devasur Sampad Vibhag Yoga. That is compromising of 24 shlokas. The Bhagavad Gita, just to tell you, has a complete of 700 shlokas in it. And this is a chapter where we talk about Lakshan and the characteristics of ideal people. Ideal people is the person who follows the path of Dharma. The next chapter is Shraddha Vibhay Yoga. And this chapter again has a way of telling us about Ahar, that is our food, Yajna, and our Tap. There are these three things which are basically discussed in this chapter. Now what happens once all these chapters are done, when Sri Krishna is trying to evoke Arjun out of his fear, out of his moha, out of his desire not to fight his own brethren and blood relatives, in the last chapter, which is the biggest chapter with 78 shlokas, it's called the Moksha Sanyas Yoga, where Arjun actually tells Sri Krishna that whatever you have taught me, I have understood that you and I have been existing in lives before and today and will be existing furthermore. Now, this is where he surrenders himself completely in mind, soul and body to Sri Krishna, who is the supreme energy and is ready to fight the war of good and evil, righteous and wrong. This is the basic gist of Bhagavad Gita. Rest, it's an endless topic. We can, I think, talk umpteen with it. And the small part where I would like to show you how homeopathy worked with me for was that when we learn the chapter of Rajasic, Tamasic and Sattvic characters, there's a particular concept in homeopathy of psoriasis, psychosis and syphilis. I tried to compare that and it worked quite nicely for me in my clinical practice using it. Another part where once, if we ever get a chance, we'll sit and discuss about Karn, how he was abandoned, how he was left by his mother and what kind of problems he developed. There's another character called Bhishma Pitama, who was the most righteous person, but because of his allegiance to the wrong party, because of his commitment and allegiance to Adharma, had to fight. And he died with a lot of arrows on, in his body, where we tried to find out what kind of medicine would that person be who decided to lead a life of celibacy all through and just his commitment to the throne. But look at the irony of the commitment, that even looking at Draupadi's clothes being pulled off her, he could not open his mouth. He was muted. He did not fight and stand for a lady against the king he had given his obedience and allegiance to. So it's a very beautiful story. There's a homeopathic medicine which comes out like Aurum here. And it's a very, very beautiful connection. And let's try and get into the depth of it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Archana. You gave me a brilliant idea. And the idea is that there is constantly the Aurum inside us. And when we are going through a conflict, we are constantly wondering whether we should stay muted and take the conflict, because the conflicts are generated by the people who you allow them to create that conflict within you. Absolutely. And you stay muted because of your loyalty, and you stay muted because you think that's something that was happening in Mahabharata many years ago is continuing to happen even today. And continues to go on with it forever,
exactly,
ever.
Exactly, exactly, Anu. That is what it is, that for every era, there's a truth. For every era, there's a truth, and there is a battle in every era to win over the current evil. The evil might change its way, its shape, its size, but it's there. It was there then, it is there now.
Exactly.
It hasn't changed. We are still fighting, and we are fighting Mahabharat within ourselves also every day. You know, there's a Mahabharat going inside us. Aapne subah alarm lagaya na, subah uthne ka, you want to go for a jog. And, you know, you say, oh no, the session was very late, you know, I just can't get up. The right and the wrong are fighting in your mind, Anu, in the morning, just to get up and go for a walk. It's as simple as that. That's a Mahabharat. It can be anywhere existing. Absolutely. Anything can be a Mahabharat for you. Just the right and the wrong.
Absolutely. So thank you very much. This was the Diwali bonus today. And I will be coming back with the show, with a new face, with a new way, and we'll call it the season 2. I'm going to take 3 weeks of a holiday. I deserve it. I need it. We've been working for 7.5 months consistently and constantly. I'm putting a wish out there that India will be in a better place and we are not bringing bad COVID over here. But you never know. Whatever it is, the season 2 will bring its own fun, its own flavor, and its own stories. So thank you very much. Thank you to
everyone. Thank you, Anu. And thank you, everyone, for listening to me so patiently. Thank you very much. Thank you. Have a great season. Have a great Diwali. And God bless.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye. Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you, Aarti. Thank you, Binay.
Meet you in season 2. I love that.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. And we shall return.
Yes.
Till we come back again for the season.
Oh, yes.
The season 2 returns.
Yes. See you, everyone. God bless.
Bye.
Bye-bye.